Hi, everybody. It's Bonnie. I'm talking to you from Toronto. So congratulations, you guys. My God, have you done us proud.
Thank you. Thank you. Awesome. It's great to meet you.
Yeah. Charles, let's start with you because what a powerful, powerful script, movie. It's just fantastic. And I wanted to know from you, what was the initiative to start writing this story, to get it out to the screen, to get so there's no gloss, there's no glamour, it's real, it's the real thing, and I'm glad that you didn't kind of gloss over that. What was the initiative for you?
I think, you know, the way that these things developed creatively, I think it was questions and feelings and responses and things that I've observed. I think before I actually, you know, ended up in film, you know, so I think there are things that are I was experiencing. I was just telling a story literally about when I was in England and I was met a cousin who's a Rastafarian and he educated me about a lot of things when I was 17 years old. And then when I came back to Toronto, my mother freaked out because I had dreadlocks. And the reason why she freaked out was because on the cover of a lot of newspapers, there were black boys with dreadlocks that were completely criminalized. It was plainly, she told me that she was concerned for my life because of the style, because of my hair. And so taking that in, and then the questions around, you know, the criminalization of black boys, the idea of generational trauma and that cycle of it, was something that was in my artwork when I was doing visual art, and then I ended up in film, and after making Nurse Fighter Boy, I really felt, you know, that I want to do something around this story and this matter. When I was at the Canadian Film Center, my second short film is a story about four black women dealing with the loss of one of the boys to gun violence and how it affected these four generations of women. So it's been something that's been in me, but with this sort of space, I did want to really look at the political hand in how that perpetuates violence and criminal activity and governance and these ideas, our origin. So Akilah is a massive manifestation of all that, and it's part origin story, part reckoning story, and through a character study, you know, and very blessed to have Saul and Tamala, like, you know, lead this space of telling this story, bring this story to life.
Yeah, really amazing. Saul, let's go to you. Congratulations, you're outstanding, and kudos to you on your acting job in this, seriously. I want to know, first of all, what your initial reaction was to the script, to the story, and to taking on this role. But I also want to know how your background as a musician, as a rapper, helped you form this great performance.
Sure. Well, you know, first off, I think the first time I read the script, my initial reaction was, I need to read it again. And that's because of the layers, the subtle layers of wonderful writing and backstory that I wanted to be clear on, which is, you know, one of the qualities that I really appreciate in Charles as an artist, as a writer, and in this story in particular, was the subtleties. You know, a great deal of the story is told by you spending time with the character in a car, you know, without words. You get a sense of the character, you know, not really by him telling you who he is, although you do get glimpses that you eventually piece together and are able to draw conclusions about what makes or made this person this way, you know. So that's the first thing that I appreciated in Charles and Motion's writing was the subtlety in the narrative, you know, especially playing within the context of genre and crime noir, you know, which as a genre, I was very excited about that, very excited, you know, that Charles would offer me a role that wasn't simply, you know, playing with how the other roles that I've been offered, which is a whole other category of stuff. So I was excited. I was excited to physically train. I was excited, you know, about all of that stuff. So then your second question, first off, you know, my first love is really theater and acting. I grew up in the theater in New York, training as an actor and simultaneously training or playing as a rapper, you know, and my relationship to hip hop, of course, shifted tremendously because of my relationship to theater. Because it was through the theater writers that I encountered and the preparation for doing a play, sitting around a table and breaking down, you know, the objectives of a character, all these things that you would do before you'd get to blocking, that helped me learn how to write and how to truly enjoy writing and what to look for in writing, you know? And in that way, I kind of moved through hip hop closer and closer to poetry and my appreciation of poetry. And so there's that. There's the relationship to music itself. And because I feel like music helps make one a better listener. I mean, there's so much, you know, we think of young musicians like having, you know, wanting you to hear this and you got to hear this and blah, 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 blah. But I really, the musicians that I admire and love has a lot to do with their sensibility, and it has a lot to do with how they've trained their ear to hear things. And I see singing and rapping as, and, you know, musicianship as corresponding with, you know, how you're hearing. It's one of the things that you appreciate when you work with artists who are wonderful at improvisation, you know. It's because of their ability to sink into something that's being established and kind of make sense of it, you know? And that, of course, yes, plays into how I would choose to portray a character as an actor, because there is a great deal of listening involved. And it's that kind of listening that you look for, whether on stage or on screen, that can inform choices beyond, you know, the theoretics of a choice, but that go with, you know, a lot of great directors will inform actors that, like, I want to see you listening in that scene, not just preparing for the next thing you have to say. Absolutely. But I need to feel that what you're saying is a response to what's been said. And so I think that my relationship to music has enhanced my understanding as a listener. And I think that that does greatly inform how I play as an actor. And Charles, with this script, really provided an opportunity to explore that.
And to listen.
That's right.
See, I was listening, Saul. I was listening. Tamla, let's go to you. My gosh, are you ever fantastic in this movie? Well, I honestly, like, each performance is just, it's better than the next, unreal. And I want to ask you, I mean, here you are, young actor, and you get the opportunity to play two fantastic parts. So how did you go about preparing for that and kind of separate them both in your head? Like, did you treat them as completely two different characters and then just, you know, start with one and then the other? Tell me your process for this.
Well, thank you. I read the script first, and of course the script is so beautifully constructed. The narrative is really immersive. So, you know, you kind of get taken through this journey and seeing the course that these characters go through and what their focus is. And you kind of just read along and get to see the different temperatures and the different climates that each one of these characters are put in. After you read and finish, of course, you gain the understanding that that shepherd is supposed to kind of be an embodiment of young Aquila. So, you know, you have this bearing resemblance of history between these two characters with the context in the film, in addition to the, you know, the circumstances that they're placed in. So, you know, what it took for me to understand the characters was to just kind of like follow along the story and really see like the different situations that these people, that these personas are kind of guided through. So it was just a lot of just trying to consult with, you know, Charles and see where he was going with this. Like, and I even remember Charles, when he approached me with the script, like we went down, we sat down and we ate something, and he was breaking it down to me. And of course, that's the way that Charles does things. He's very personable. He's very like inviting, of course. But, you know, it became clear to me how both of these characters are involved with one another. And just through the, you know, script and of course the environment, it helped me, it aided me to properly understand how to execute this.
It was great. It was great. Charles, so much I want to ask you. My God, I wish I had an hour with you guys, but I cannot ignore those opening credits. They pack as much a punch as this film does. How challenging was that? Because people, do not scroll through these. If you're watching this at home, do not scroll through these credits. They are brilliant. That was, wow, honestly.
Yeah, it's part, you know, resources and getting creative with an idea that you have. Initially in earlier drafts, there were scenes that were constructed that we would have to go and shoot in Jamaica. And as I was learning about the process of what I was estimating what we can get to make this film, I thought it was important to kind of incorporate an opening sequence titles, but give something there. It's an opportunity to set up and give context to where this the origin of the story kind of began. And there's homages in there, you know, to Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing, and there's, you know, someone just wrote something else about that I didn't actually think about. It was actually when we were working together and Saul mentioned a filmmaker that I was familiar with, but didn't have all the sort of knowledge. But when I went to look him up again, I was like, I know his work. And then the name, Mr. Jaffa, right? And someone just wrote a review and said that the archival material in that opening, it was a homage to Jaffa and Spike Lee. And I didn't make that. And then remember, Saul, we were talking that day about him. And then I was like, okay. And, you know, so it was important to get some historical, it's weird, but it's important to get some historical context and use that space. And I love documentary filmmaking as well and try to mix that. So
yeah. Brilliant. Really, really well done. Okay, I have a few minutes left, so I'm going to go to each one of you. Given what's going on in our world today, this film is more poignant than ever, honestly, and I just really hope people watch this and take a lot from it. So, Saul, let's start with you. If people leave the theater and they start one conversation, what is it that you would like them to talk about?
Well, I think that, you know, that they should bear witness to the question that Charles is talking about, which is, how do we put an end to generational trauma? And so there's room for many responses, because on one hand, we can look at what we need to do in our lives to think of the role that, let's say, capitalism and patriarchy has played in shaping us. And then we might also look at the laws and the systems that govern us and realize that we also, you know, it's crucial that we make changes there as well. And so, you know, that's the question, the main question that I feel Charles was approaching with this film. And I think that's what I would like audiences to walk away with, is that question. How do we put an end to, you know, the cyclical nature of generational trauma?
Okay, Tamala, how about you? You know, young,
Bonnie, young. Wrap it up just because we're getting more delayed.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I wish I could get the answers from you guys, but anyway, listen, we got a great answer from Saul on that. Thank you so much, and congratulations. And Charles, just congratulations on this being at TIFF. I know that means a lot to you. And again, just as a fellow Torontonian, I'm just so proud and so happy to be able to talk to you guys for this. Thanks so much for your time.